I want to conclude with a vector that relates the magnetic and electric field in a traveling wave. You remember in my dipole, I had an electric field amplitude that was oscillating in the up and down direction, and I had then in the plane perpendicular to that, a magnetic field that was oscillating. That's a general result in a set of equations called Maxwell's equations. When the electric field is at a maximum, I also have a maximum in the magnetic field, which is represented by this blue arrow. There's a vector relation, in fact, between the direction of the electric field in a wave, the magnetic field in the wave, and the velocity of propagation, which is that way. It's another one of the right-hand rules. The velocity of propagation is in the direction of E cross B. So you turn E into B with the right hand, and the thumb points in the direction of propagation. So all this radiation one should imagine as being such that I have these oscillating electric and magnetic fields that are moving along at the speed of light. We want to talk now about the instruments that are used for measuring voltages and currents. There are two classes of these instruments. There's a modern solid state set of instruments that typically have digital readouts that are for voltage and current reading. And then there's another group of instruments that are based upon measurements of electromagnetic forces in an instrument called a galvanometer. And the discussion today is going to be about instruments based upon the principle of a galvanometer. And the basic idea here, and this is the raw elements of such a galvanometer, is that we have usually a permanent magnet, which is this red horseshoe magnet that I have here, and a coil. When I pass a current through the coil, it produces a magnetic moment that interacts with the permanent magnet, and I get a force which can cause a deflection of my meter. And I have current going one way, and you'll notice that the pointer goes in one direction. If I reverse the current by just changing the terminals on the battery, the torque is in the opposite direction, and I have the meter deflection in the opposite direction. As I have a magnetic moment that's proportional to the current passing through this coil that produces a torque when it's in this permanent magnet, and the size of the torque is proportional to the current through the loop. So the galvanometer is intrinsically an instrument that gives us a deflection that's proportional to the amount of current that goes through it. The amount of the deflection depends upon the spring constants, and if we look at some of these meters that we have over here, for instance this one, you will see that there is a tight spring that looks very much like a watch spring that controls the balance in the torque and the motion of the meter. It can be used for damping the meter and so forth. All right, this one basic instrument can be used to measure a variety of currents and also can be used to measure potential differences, and let's look at how we modify the instrument by addition of extra elements in order to make it a ammeter with a specified current range or a voltmeter. Suppose this instrument had for its basic deflection full scale, that is that the meter deflected full scale with 1 milliamp, and that the electrical resistance of my coil is 1 ohm. That means without doing anything else to it, I'll get a full-scale deflection of my meter with 1 milliamp current passing through it. And the thing that I will have understand to mean when I write the symbol A in some sort of a circuit through which I want to pass current is that I have a device that has a resistance of 1 ohm, and it'll be full-scale deflection with a 1 milliampere current passing through it. Suppose I wish to modify that in order to have the current be 1 ampere for full scale. Well, the way this is done is to actually place a very low resistance element in parallel with the meter so that most of the current passes through this shunt, is the name of this element, instead of through the meter. We just bleed a little bit of current in parallel through the meter. So I have 1 ampere going into a network that will contain the meter and my parallel resistance element. This will be my resistor R in parallel, the shunt resistance. And now I have 1 ohm going through the for 1 milliamp going through the galvanometer. Now, in order to calculate how much resistance I have to put in parallel, I observe that I have 1 ampere going into the system, and it wants to split with a certain fraction of the current going through the shunt resistor and 1 milliamp going through the meter itself. Well, the current obviously has to split so that 999 milliamperes go through the resistance R, and that has to be a much smaller resistance than the resistance of the meter itself. And the size of that resistance is just proportional to the ratio of the currents. That is, 1 milliamp divided by 999 milliamps, current going through the upper branch, must be equal to the resistance R divided by 1 ohm. Okay? So that evidently R should be equal to, if I say this is 10 to the minus 3 amperes, to put that in resistance, it's going to be equal to 1.001 times 10 to the minus 3 ohms. So I can make this meter into a meter that reads 1 ampere full scale by adding a very small resistance in parallel, approximately 10 to the minus 3 ohms. Now, there is a correction that one sometimes has to worry about with meters. In the case of my ammeter here, it has a finite resistance, and it can change the amount of current that flows in the circuit when I install it. For instance, back as a milliammeter, let's see how it would change the current flowing in a simple circuit. Suppose I have a 1 volt battery. And I install my milliammeter here in series with that and 1,000 ohms. If I have no resistance in my meter, if it's perfect, or if I just put a short circuit around it for the time being, then the current flowing in this circuit, I equal V over R, would be equal to 1 over 1,000. Would be equal to 1.00 times 10 to the minus 3, or 1 milliampere. But with a real meter where I have a real resistance of 1 ohm, when I'm making my measurement, the total resistance in the circuit now is going to be 1,000 ohms plus 1 ohm, so that I will have 1001 here, and then the current that will flow through the circuit will be 0.999, and I will have a small correction because this is not a perfect meter. An ideal ammeter is one with zero electrical resistance. Of course, we can only approach the ideal case. Suppose I wish to make this instrument into a voltmeter. Now, a voltmeter is an instrument that is used to measure the potential difference between two elements in a circuit, and we can arrange this so that some of the current in the circuit is bled off to pass through the galvanometer to cause a deflection that's proportional to the voltage. For instance, using the same meter again, suppose I wanted to measure the potential drop across a resistor. Here's a resistor R, and there's a current I flowing through it, and I want to know what the potential drop between this point and that point might be. And the way I achieve this is by placing a resistor in series with my galvanometer so that I have the desired calibration features. For instance, suppose I wish this galvanometer to have a deflection, full-scale deflection, when there is 10 volt potential difference between here and there. That is, when the potential is V is equal to 10 volts. Once again, the current I in the circuit there would be 1 milliampere, so that the resistance that we have to add in is going to be determined by Ohm's law again. V equal I times R. So for this example, I said that the potential was 10 volts. The current for that particular meter is 1 times 10 to the minus 3 amperes. And the total resistance will be my extra resistance that I add in series, R, plus the 1 ohm for my meter. We can solve this. So R plus 1 is equal to 10 to the 4th ohms. And now R, the extra series resistance that I need to add to my galvanometer to make it into a voltmeter, will be equal to 9,999 ohms. So that if I do that, add this resistance in series with my meter, it can then be used as a voltmeter. Pretend that that's in the box. And this is typical of the series resistors that were designed to be added to these delicate galvanometers. This worked perfectly well until I have to measure the potential drop across large resistors. For instance, if I had a resistor here of 1 million ohms and I tried to use this instrument as we've designed it here for a measurement, the current would primarily go through my meter itself because it would have only a resistance of 10 to the 4th ohms, so that my, once again, will have a serious correction that I have to apply when I use this instrument in measuring potential drop across large resistors. The ideal voltmeter then should have as large a apparent resistance as possible. That's another statement, is so that the correction comes about because we want to have the minimum amount of current drained from the circuit in making the measurement. The ideal voltmeter should have an infinite apparent resistance. The ideal ammeter should have zero resistance.